Muy buenas tardes. Bienvenidos todos a la cátedra abierta en homenaje a Roberto Bolaño. Hoy día tenemos una invitada muy especial. Su nombre es Edwige Danticat. Ella es de origen haitiano, de hecho nació en Puerto Príncipe, pero a partir de los 12 años se mudó a vivir con su familia que había emigrado a Nueva York. Y fue en ese país donde comenzó su carrera literaria, una carrera literaria en inglés. Como muchas familias inmigrantes, primero viajó su padre, 2 años después viajó su madre a Nueva York, y ella permaneció en Puerto Príncipe, en casa de unos tíos, junto con su hermano André, y permaneció hasta los 12 años. Esos años formativos resultaron ser muy provechosos para su literatura, pues en la literatura se puede escuchar el eco de ese criol haitiano, que es el lenguaje de la intimidad hablado en su casa, y también parte de la estructura francesa, que es fruto de la educación formal de sus primeros años. Esta etapa también pertenecen sus primeros cuentos. Al parecer, ella comienza a escribir a los 9 años. Y como les conté, llega a los 12 a Nueva York y solamente 2 años después de su llegada ya estaba escribiendo en inglés. Su primer relato fue publicado a los 14 años por una revista destinada a la juventud, llamada New Youth Connections. Ella estudió literatura francesa en el Barnard College de la ciudad de Nueva York y una maestría en creación literaria en la Universidad de Brown. Su trabajo de titulación fue una versión abreviada de una novela que más tarde, solo un año después, fue publicada. Esta se llama Breath, Eyes, Memory y fue publicada en Soho Press en el año 1994. Ese fue un libro que 4 años más tarde fue seleccionado por Oprah Winfrey para su club de lectura. Esto es un fenómeno que nosotros no tenemos acá en Chile. Ese club de lectura es una instancia que ha logrado extender y ampliar la base de lectores de manera significativa y abarca casi todos los géneros literarios y todos los temas. Entrar a ese club de lectura como autor significa multiplicar también, por supuesto, la cantidad de lectores, alcanzar audiencias más grandes y, por supuesto, nuevas puertas que se abren. Quizás por eso fue que en el año 1997 la revista Granta la escoge como una de las autoras más prominentes de Estados Unidos. Como saben ustedes, esta selección que hace la revista Granta, que también la hace en Latinoamérica, pone un límite de años y son generalmente personas menores de 40 años. Bueno, Danticat fue seleccionada recién a sus 27 años. Eso es un logro bastante notable. Por mucho tiempo, ella se dedicó, además de escribir, a hacer clases de escritura en los magísteres de creación literaria, en parte en el que se da en la Universidad de Nueva York y también en parte en lo que se en el programa que se dicta en la Universidad de Miami. Desde su primera novela, Danticat es una autora que ha logrado forjar un espacio en el imaginario cultural para la comunidad haitiana. En una industria literaria que tiende a premiar a las voces que exotizan su identidad y sus orígenes, ella ha logrado resistir, creando un retrato muy complejo de su comunidad y de la intersección lingüística que habita. En ella confluye no solo la disputa política e identitaria, sino que una rica elaboración de la memoria, la observación aguda de la relación entre mujeres, especialmente el vínculo de madre e hija, y en términos más amplios, aporta su particular visión de los procesos y experiencias migratorias. Para nosotros es un lujo tenerla hoy día en la cátedra abierta en homenaje a Roberto Bolaño. Y me refiero a que es un lujo porque es una oportunidad de escuchar a alguien que tiene algo que decir, frente a los conflictos que atraviesa el mundo y también que son parte del tejido de nuestro país. Me refiero a conflictos que se relacionan con la migración, conflictos que están relacionados con la aceptación de las diferencias y también con la capacidad de diálogo. Entonces, quería darle la bienvenida a Edwidge Dantecat. Edwidge, welcome to Chile, at least through the screen, but we feel your presence very close to us, not only because we can see your image, but because your book is finally available in Spanish, and it has gathered a considerable community of readers. So, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you. Buenas tardes a todos. Bonsoir tout le monde. Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for having me. It's thank you, Rodrigo, for being in conversation with me. I will start by reading from the first chapter of Create Dangerously. I want to also thank my publishers who made it possible for the book to be published in Chile. It's a great honor for me to be here, even virtually with you. So this is from the first chapter of Create Dangerously, and then afterwards I have some images that I will talk more casually about to fill in the picture throughout the whole book. So this is from Create Dangerously, the immigrant artist at work. On November 12, 1964, in Port-au-Prince, Haiti, a huge crowd gathered to witness an execution. The president of Haiti at that time was the dictator, François Papadoc Duvalier, who was 7 years into what would be a 15-year term. On the day of the execution, he decreed that government offices be closed so that hundreds of state employees could be in the crowd. Schools were shut down and principals ordered to bring their students. Hundreds of people from outside the capital were bussed in to watch. The two men to be executed were Marcel Numa and Louis Douin. Marcel Numa was a tall, dark-skinned 21-year-old. He was from a family of coffee planters in a beautiful southern Haitian town called Jérémy, which is often dubbed the City of Poets. Numa had studied engineering at the Bronx Merchant Academy in New York and had worked for an American shipping company. Louis Douin, nicknamed Milou, was a 31-year-old light-skinned man who was also from Jérémy. He had served in the U.S. Army at Forks Knox and then at Fort Dix in New Jersey, and had studied finance before working for French, Swiss, and American banks in New York. Marcel Numa and Louis Douin had been childhood friends in Jérémy. The man had remained friends when they'd both moved to New York in the 1950s after François Duvalier came to power. There, they had joined a group called Jeune Haïti and were two of 13 Haitians who left the United States for Haiti in 1964 to engage in the guerrilla war that they hoped would eventually topple the dictatorship. The men of Jeune Haïti spent 3 months fighting in the hills and mountains of southern Haiti, and eventually most of them died in battle. Marcel Numa was captured by members of Duvalier's army while he was shopping for food in an open market, dressed as a paysan, a peasant. Louis Douin was wounded in battle and asked his friends to leave him behind in the woods. According to our principals, I should have committed suicide in that situation, Douin reportedly declared in a final statement at his secret military trial. Chandler and Gerdes, two other Jeune Haïti members, were wounded. Chandler, the first one, asked his best friend to finish him off, The second one committed suicide after destroying a case of ammunition and all the documents. That did not affect me. I reacted only after the disappearance of Marcel Numa, who had been sent to look for food and for some means of escape by sea. We were very close and our parents were friends," end quote, from Douin. After months of attempting to capture the men of Jeune Haïti, and after imprisoning and murdering hundreds of their relatives, Papadoc François Duvalier wanted to make a spectacle of Numa and Douin's deaths. So on November 12, 1964, two pine poles are erected outside the National Cemetery. A captive audience is gathered. Radio, print, and television journalists are summoned. Numa and Douin are dressed in what in an old black and white film seems to be the clothes in which they had been captured. Khakis for Douin and a modest white shirt and denim-looking pants for Numa. They are both marched from the edge of the crowd towards the poles. Their hands are tied behind their backs by two of Duvalier's private henchmen, Tonton Macoutes in dark glasses and civilian dress. The Tonton Macoutes then tie the ropes around the men's biceps to bind them to the poles and keep them upright. Numa, the taller and thinner of the two men, stands erect in perfect profile, barely leaning against the square piece of wood behind him. Douin, who wears brow-lined eyeglasses, looks down into the film camera that is taping his final moments. Douin looks as though he is fighting back tears as he stands there, strapped to the pole, slightly slanted. Douin's arms are shorter than Numa's, and the rope appears looser on Douin. While Numa looks straight ahead, Douin pushes his head back now and then to rest it on the pole. Time is slightly compressed on the copy of the film I have, and in some places the images skip. There is no sound. A large crowd stretches out far beyond the cement wall behind the bound Numa and Douin. To the side is a balcony filled with school children. Some time elapses, it seems, as the school children and others mill around. The soldiers shift their guns from one hand to the other. Some audience members shield their faces from the sun by raising their hands to their forehead. Some sit idly on a low stone wall. A young white priest in a long robe walks out of the crowd with a prayer book in his hands. It seems that he is the person everyone has been waiting for. The priest says a few words to Douin, who slides his body upward in a defiant pose. Douin motions with his head towards his friend. The priest spends a little more time with Numa, who bobs his head as the priest speaks. If this is Numa's extreme unction, it is an abridged version. The priest then returns to Douin and is joined there by a stout macoute and plain clothes and by two uniformed policemen who lean in to listen to what the priest is saying to Douin. It is possible that they are all offering Douin some type of eye or face cover that he is refusing. Douin shakes his head as if to say, "Let's get it over with." No blinders or hoods are placed on either man. The firing squad, seven helmeted men in khaki military uniforms, stretch out their hands on either side of their bodies. They touch each other's shoulders to position and space themselves. The police and army move the crowd back, perhaps to keep them from being hit by ricocheted bullets. The members of the firing squad pick up their Springfield rifles, load their ammunition, and then place their weapons on their shoulders. Off screen, someone probably shouts, "Fire!" And they do. Numa and Dwen's heads slumped sideways at the same time, showing that the shots have hit home. When the men's bodies slide down the poles, Numa's arms end up slightly above his shoulders and Dwen's below his. Their heads return to an upright position above their kneeling bodies until a soldier in camouflage walks over and delivers the final coup de grace, after which their heads slump forward and their bodies slide further towards the bottom of the pole. Blood spills out of Numa's mouth. Doin's glasses fall to the ground, pieces of blood and brain matter clouding the cracked lenses. The next day, Le Matin, the country's national newspaper, described the stunned-looking crowd as, quote, feverish, communicating in a mutual patriotic exaltation to curse adventurism and brigandage, end quote. The government's pamphlets circulating in Port-au-Prince last week left little to the imagination, reported the November 27, 1964 edition of the American newsweekly Time. Quote, Dr. François Duvalier will fulfill his sacrosanct mission. He has crushed and will always crush the attempts of the opposition. Think well, renegades. Here is the fate awaiting you and your kind. All artists, writers among them, have several stories. One might call them creation myths that haunt and obsess them. This is one of mine. I don't even remember when I first heard about it. I feel as though I've always known it, having filled in the curiosity-driven details through photographs, newspapers and magazine articles, books and films, as I have gotten older. Like many a creation myth, aside from its heart-rending clash of life and death, homeland and exile, the execution of Marcel Numa and Louis Dwen involves a disobeyed directive from a higher authority and a brutal punishment as a result. If we think back to the biggest creation myth of all, the world's very first people, Adam and Eve, disobeyed the superior being that fashioned them out of chaos, defying God's order not to eat what must have been the world's most desirable apple. Adam and Eve were then banished from Eden, resulting in everything from our having to punch a clock to spending many, 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 many painful hours giving birth. The order given to Adam and Eve was not to eat that apple. Their ultimate punishment was banishment, exile from paradise. We, the storytellers of the world, or to be more grateful than most, that banishment, rather than execution, was chosen for Adam and Eve. For had they been executed, there would have never been another story told. No stories to pass on, as Toni Morrison wrote. In his play Caligula, Albert Camus, from whom I borrowed the title of this essay of the entire book, has Caligula, the third Roman emperor, declare that it doesn't matter whether one is exiled or executed, but it is much more important that Caligula has the power to choose. Even before they were executed, Marcel Numa and Louis Dwen had already been exiled. As young men, they had fled Haiti with their parents when Papadoc François Duvalier had come to power in 1957 and had immediately targeted for arrest all his detractors and resistors in the city of poets where they were from and also elsewhere. Marcel Numa and Louis Dwen had made new lives for themselves, becoming productive young immigrants in the United States. In addition to his army and finance experience, Louis Dwen was said to have been a good writer and the communications director of their group, Jeune Haïti. In the United States, he contributed to a Haitian political journal called L'Ambi, which is a conch shell. Marcel Numa was from a family of writers. One of his male relatives, Nono Numa, had adopted the 17th century French playwright Pierre Corneille's Le Cid, placing it in a Haitian setting. Many of the young men Numa and Douin joined with to form Jeune Haïti had had their fathers killed by Papadoc Duvalier and had returned Le Cid-like and Hamlet-like to revenge their fathers. Like most creation myths, this one too exists beyond the scope of my own life, yet it still feels present for me, even urgent. Marcel Numa and Louis Douin were patriots who died so that other Haitians could live. They were also immigrants like me, yet they had abandoned comfortable lives in the United States and sacrificed themselves for the homeland. One of the first things the despot Duvalier tried to take away from them was the mythic element of their stories. And the propaganda preceding their execution, he had labeled them not Haitian, but foreign rebels, good for nothing, blancs, or foreigners. At the time of the execution of Marcel Numa and Louis Douin, my recently married 29-year-old parents lived in Haiti in a neighborhood called Bel Air, about a 30-minute walk from the cemetery where they were executed. Bel Air had a government-sponsored community center, a centre d'études, where young men and women, but mostly young men, went to study in the evenings, especially if they had no electricity at home. Some of these young people, not my parents, but young people who studied at the center, belonged to a book club, a reading group sponsored by the Alliance Française, the French Institute. The book club was called Le Club de Bonne Humeur, or the Good Humor Club. At the time, Le Club de Bonne Humeur was reading Camus' play Caligula with an eye to possibly staging it. In Camus' version of Caligula's life, when Caligula's sister, who is also his lover, dies, Caligula unleashes his rage and slowly unravels. In a preface to the English translation of the play, Albert Camus wrote, quote, "I look in vain for philosophy in these four acts. I have little regard for an art that deliberately aims to shock because it is unable to convince." After the execution of Marcel Numa and Louis Douin, as the images of their deaths played over and over in cinemas and on state-run television, the young men and women of the Club de Bonne Humeur, along with the rest of Haiti, desperately needed art that could convince. They needed art that could convince them that they would not die the same way that Numa and Douin had. They needed to be convinced that words could still be spoken, that stories could still be told and passed on. So as my father used to tell it, these young people donned white sheets as togas and they tried to stage Camus' play quietly, quietly, in many of their houses where they whispered lines such as, this is from the play, "Execution relieves and liberates. It is a universal tonic, just in precept as in practice. A man dies because he is guilty. A man is guilty because he's one of Caligula's subjects. Ergo, all men are guilty and shall die. It is only a matter of time and patience," end quote. The legend of the underground staging of this and other plays, clandestine readings of pieces of literature, was so strong that years after Papadoc Duvalier died, every time there was a political murder in Bel Air, one of the young aspiring intellectuals in the neighborhood where I spent the first 12 years of my life might inevitably say that someone should put on a play. And because the uncle who raised me while my parents were in New York for the two-thirds of the first 12 years of my life, because my uncle was a minister in Bel Air and had a church and school with some available space, occasionally some of these plays were read and staged quietly in the backyard of his church. There are many recurrences of this story throughout the country, book and theater clubs secretly cherishing some potentially subversive piece of literature, families burying, if not burning, their entire libraries, books that might seem innocent but could easily betray them, novels with the wrong titles, treatises with the right titles and intentions, strings of words that uttered, written, or read could cause a person's death. Sometimes these words were written by Haitian writers like Marie Vieux Chauvet and René Depeste, among others. Other times they were written by foreign or blanc writers like Aimé Césaire, Frantz Fanon, Albert Camus, who were untouchable because they were either not Haitian or already long dead. The fact that death prevented one from being banished, unlike, say, the English novelist Graham Greene, who was banned from Haiti after writing The Comedians, made the classic writers all the more appealing. Unlike the country's own citizens, these writers could neither be tortured or murdered themselves, nor cause their family members to be tortured or murdered. And no matter how hard he tried, Papa Doc Duvalier could not make these words go away. Their maxims and phrases could keep coming back, buried deep in memories by the rote recitation techniques that the Haitian school system had taught so well. Because these writers were still in Haiti, not yet exiled or killed, those who were still in Haiti could not freely perform or print their own words outright. Many of them turned or returned to the Greeks. When it was time to pick up a bloodied body on the street, Haitian writers introduced Haitian readers to Sophocles' Oedipus, Rex, and Antigone, which had been rewritten in Creole and placed in Haitian settings by the playwright Franck Fouché and the poet Félix Maurice Leroy. This is where these writers placed their bets, striking a dangerous balance between silence and art. How do writers and readers find each other under such dangerous circumstances? Reading, like writing, under these conditions is disobedience to a directive in which the reader, our Eve, already knows the possible consequences of eating that apple, but takes a bold bite anyway. How does that reader find the courage to take this bite, open that book after an arrest and execution? Of course, he or she may find it in the power of the hushed chorus of other readers, but she can also find it in the writer's courage and having stepped forward and having written or rewritten in the first place. So create dangerously for people who read dangerously. This is what I've always thought it meant to be a writer. Writing, knowing in part that no matter how trivial your words may seem, someday, somewhere, someone may risk his or her life to read them. Coming from where I come from with the history I have, having spent the first 12 years of my life under both dictatorships of Papa Doc and his son Jean-Claude, this is what I've always seen as the unifying principle among all writers. This is what, among other things, might join Albert Camus and Sophocles to Toni Morrison, Alice Walker, Ossip Mendelssohn, and Ralph Waldo Emerson to Ralph Waldo Ellison. Somewhere, if not now, then maybe years in the future, a future we may have yet to dream of, someone may risk his or her life to read us. Somewhere, if not now, then maybe years in the future, we may also save someone's life because they have given us a passport, making us honorary citizens of their culture. So now I will transition to the presentation. I just will show some slides. Let's hope it works. All right. We said that if we didn't have a mishap, then it wouldn't be the right. Okay. So I will attempt to share my screen. Can you see this okay? Can you see the screen, Rodrigo?
Yes.
Okay, yes. So this is
the... see the screen.
Okay, so I'll just even, like, I'll linger a bit on the original version of the book. So this painting is a painting, oh my gosh, I'm freaking out on the name of the... Pascal Monet is the artist, and... right after this was painted right after the January 10, 2010 earthquake. And I remember seeing it right afterwards, and it seemed so fitting with, it was an immediate reaction from Pascal. She wrote some poems with it, and I thought it was a good cover for the book. So with Marcel Numa and Louis Douin, the film that I describe, I never show that the film when I in public because it's very disturbing. But the stills are still disturbing, but so that people can get an image of exactly what that was like. This is the scene there with the two men and the poles, and it seems they were there quite a while before. There was a lot of sort of milling around before. It was like a spectacle, as I describe. This is another version of that. And this is them after they died. And just to show you how we, the people of Haiti, never really forgot them. This is on the 50th anniversary of this execution. In 2014, and there were these murals. There's an organization, Devoir de Mémoire, and these murals were in Port-au-Prince and honoring them, so they were never forgotten. I mentioned the Frank Fauché and Félix Maurice Auloi, who had staged Antigone. Had translated Antigone and Oedipus Rex. So this is what they look like. And Félix Maurice Auloi actually died in Miami and not far from where I am speaking to you right now. Later, there's a chapter in the book on Jean-Michel Basquiat called Welcoming Ghost with Hippolyte. So this is the painter Hippolyte who I mentioned in that chapter. And this is some of his work. So I'm giving you past the first chapter, but a little preview of the book. This is some of Hippolyte's work, which the comparison with, so Jean-Michel Basquiat, I talk about this in the book, was interviewed by someone who, because he's half Haitian, half Puerto Rican, and Jean-Michel Basquiat is the world-renowned artist from New York, whose mother was Puerto Rican, from Puerto Rico, and his father was from Haiti, and he was always asked if he had primitives on his wall. And the gentleman who asked him about the primitives meant naive or primitive art. But Basquiat flipped it around. He's like, "You mean people? Do I have primitive people on my wall?" And there's an essay, "Welcoming Ghost," in the book where I try to imagine that. If there was someone like this gentleman was asking Jean-Michel Basquiat about it on his wall, it probably would have been this guy. They had really very different styles, but some affinity. And Hippolyte often he would say that his art was guided by the spirits and the loi, you know, the divine was guiding him. Myra Darren had a very interesting saying about sort of how the spirit guides art. I feel like I had it here, but where she said only the spirits are able to, you know, in the same way that he believed that the guidance of spirits with art. Also, speaking of, this is another chapter in the book about this artist named Michael Richards. And the powerful thing about Michael Richards' experience was that he was painting for a long time, Saint Sebastian, who you see here in this arrow, and he was painting from the top of the World Trade Center. The World Trade Center, sometimes they allowed artists to have the empty offices that nobody was renting. And he got one of those offices and was painting from, it was sculpting these images for a long time with a man with airplanes coming through his body. And this is how he died during 9/11, literally with an airplane going through his body. And I, there's a chapter on him in the book too, where for me, that was so powerful and striking, and almost in, you know, in the presentation, I talk about the sort of the political nature of art, but his Dangerous Creation is almost a prophetic nature of art. Like, it's almost as if he was obsessed with flight, you know, that was, and he ended up dying in this way. So this is more of the, he had several versions of this sculpture, and actually in a few months there will be an exhibit of his work not far from here, and I'll get to see these in person. I've never seen them in person, but he had one in his where he had his office in the World Trade Center, but he also had several versions that he had in the homes of relatives, which is how some of these ended up surviving. But you can see in the different variations that this was a very obsession for him, but which was also inspired by the Tuskegee Airmen, who were these black pilots who flew and fought during World War II. So I mentioned, I tried in the book to, really what drove me to write that book is to find out how different people come to their art. And so among the school children that I mentioned was this man, Daniel Moel, who is an extraordinary photojournalist. And he was there at that execution. And he, after the execution, after the men were killed, he was with his friends. They walked over and he said he picked up the glasses of Duin. With all the blood on it. He picked it up, and then some other child grabbed it from him. And the next day, having been at the execution, then the next day, his father had a bakery on a main street in the city. And then he kept seeing the images that the government had made of the execution, in part what you saw earlier. And they had them posted all over town. And just as in the chapter of the book, in the Time magazine, it was supposed to be a warning to people who would think to do the same thing. And so he said, as a child, when he saw these images, you know, he would go to the movies and they would play the film of the execution to frighten people. And then it made him realize the power of images as a young man. And he said, I'm going to do this. I'm going to document, I'm going to make images, but for another purpose, for a contrary purpose than what that he was forced to see when he was a young man. So this is him in Port-au-Prince, and he was one of the first photographers to photograph people after the earthquake. These are some of his images. And he often says, you know, that people criticize him for not having more positive image, but he sees himself as someone who is documenting some harsh realities. These are, again, some of the first images after the earthquake, and they were taken by him. He just happened to be in this part of the city, in Grandrue downtown, and was one of the first people to photograph after the earthquake. So it's a very circular life he has had, coming from a young man who was forced to witness something very drastic and very graphic, but he became someone who documents pain in a way that we have not seen. So again, this is, I began with that image sort of in the ever present of their dying, but I wanted to close with this image of remembering of how we remember these men, which is what also part of what I wanted to do in the story, to talk about their lives and their sacrifice as I lead into this discussion about art and activism that is framed in many, many different ways. So gracias, thank you. I will stop sharing now.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Okay. So thank you very much, Edwidge. If you allow me just 1 minute, so that I will do an overview of pictures that you have just shown.
Absolutely.
So that the people who missed some details can follow our conversation.
Okay.
Bueno, voy a hacer un resumen general de las fotos que acaba de compartir Edwidge Danticat, porque estas van a formar, digamos, la discusión que vamos a tener ahora a partir de las preguntas. En la primera imagen está una pintora de apellido Pascal, es una pintura ejecutada justo después del terremoto de Haití en el año 2010. Y luego, la segunda, tercera, cuarta y quinta foto son fotos de la ejecución de Numa y de Drouin, y que son fotos que ella nunca muestra en público. Tiene cierto resquemor de hacer la muerte una especie de espectáculo, pero necesita mostrar esas imágenes para poder establecer cómo estas todavía siguen rondando el imaginario político de Haití, y de ahí viene la sexta imagen, que es un mural pintado en noviembre del año 2014, donde muestra a los dos líderes políticos justamente en el momento de la ejecución. Después muestra la foto de los dos directores teatrales que montaron Antígona, y justamente son de los que ella se refiere en el texto sobre el Instituto Francés de la Alianza Francesa. Luego está el pintor Hippolyte, que es un pintor que era seguido por Jean-Michel Basquiat, y hay unas fotos ahí de su trabajo, y hay una anécdota que ella comparte, que en una entrevista que le hacen a Basquiat, porque recordemos que él tiene un origen mixto entre Puerto Rico y también entre Haití, y tenía algunas pinturas de Hippolyte puestas en sus paredes, y el reportero le hace una pregunta acerca de los primitivos, refiriéndose, por cierto, a la pintura primitivista o naif, y ahí Basquiat hace un giro con esa expresión y le pregunta, bueno, ¿te refieres a la gente primitiva en mi pared? Entonces, a eso le da pie ella para hablar de un arte guiado por los espíritus, y por esto, con esto ella está incluyendo también una noción de mundo que incluye las religiones, digamos, que son herencias de la diáspora africana. Después está una foto de Michael Richards, que es un artista a quien ella se refiere en otro capítulo del libro, que no leyó ahí. En esta foto se ve Michael Richards con algunas obras suyas, una de ellas de San Sebastián, y luego unas obras escultóricas donde representa un aviador de raza negra vestido con uniforme de piloto de la Segunda Guerra Mundial, que hace referencia a un pequeño grupo de pilotos de color que participaron en esta guerra. Aquí la ironía es que este artista, obsesionado con el vuelo y que representa al cuerpo del ser humano, un cuerpo de un hombre de color, intervenido por aviones y por un vuelo, justamente muere como fruto del choque de un avión, porque su estudio estaba en las Torres Gemelas, en una de las oficinas que la administración de las torres cedía a artistas cuando no estaban arrendadas. Entonces él terminó sus días ahí. Y luego ya en las imágenes 14 hasta las 17 están las fotos de Daniel Morel, que cuando niño él vio la ejecución. De hecho, él se acercó a uno de los cuerpos, al cuerpo de Drouin, y estuvo a punto de quedarse con sus anteojos, los perdió, se los quitó otro niño, pero esta experiencia con las imágenes que no lo dejaban, influyó también en su formación como artista visual. Ahora es un fotógrafo, y a continuación mostró muchas de estas imágenes de gente sufriendo después del terremoto del 2010. Y con eso ella termina en esta conjunción de la observación, de la construcción de imágenes, de la conciencia política y también las obras artísticas. Y a partir de eso es que vamos a conversar. Ahora vamos a abrir las preguntas. Tenemos algunas preguntas que se han hecho por chat del YouTube, y también tenemos algunas preguntas que han sido enviadas en forma de video. Yo no sé, Manuel, si estamos listos para mostrar el video, o si quieres podemos empezar con las preguntas enviadas por chat. Bueno, vamos a empezar, mientras preparan el video, vamos a empezar con algunas preguntas por chat, at which we received questions through the chat in YouTube, the people who were watching your exposition, and also someone sent us a video. I will start first by one question that we received during the chat. This is Carolina Reyes. She was following the reading, and she was waiting for you to get to the passage where you talk about Osip Mandelstam, and because she was very interested in the place in which the Caribbean meets Eastern Europe. So she was wondering what kinds of links, cultural links, there are between the Caribbean and Eastern Europe, or perhaps your own personal experience as a reader and writer.
Oh, yes. Well, I tell her, we were trying to keep it not too long, but I was reading, there's probably similar in terms of their moments of censorship, and maybe that's the connection. But I was reading Osip Mandelstam when I was writing my book called The Dew Breaker, which is about a torturer. And I remember coming, and I tend to read some poetry when I'm writing in a particular way. So when I was writing that book about the torture, I was reading a bit of, I was reading Osip Mandelstam. I remember coming across, maybe this is the beginning of madness. Forgive me for what I'm saying. Read it quietly, quietly. And so for me, that was like, wow, that felt really connected with this dangerous creation and how people were writing during the dictatorship, right? So that I felt a very powerful connection with that work, either with the element of censorship and repression that he was talking about, but of the word. And I thought this idea of like, do it quietly, quietly, because the book that I was writing at that time, I was writing about a torturer. I felt even my parents would not have been happy about, they would have been nervous. even though the dictatorship was over, I think they would have still been nervous about it. So that I felt like this was actually a message. I used that as an epigraph, almost as a message for my parents. Read it quietly, quietly.
Okay. Edwidge habla más que una conexión entre el Caribe y el este de Europa. Ella habla de una conexión más bien personal. Para poder escribir sobre la dictadura, la experiencia de represión y tortura en Haití, ella estaba buscando testimonios literarios que le sirvieran para poder describirle esta experiencia. Es así como ella llega a un texto de Osip Mandelson, donde el autor pide que el texto se lea despacito, como si fuera el comienzo de la locura. Entonces, esa posición le sirvió a ella para acercarse a la experiencia de la tortura y más bien su conexión personal con esos años, puesto que si bien la dictadura en Haití ya había acabado hace tiempo, todavía en su familia y en la comunidad costaba mucho referirse a estos temas. Ok, Manuel, quizás ahora podríamos pasar al video que nos enviaron con la pregunta.
Buenas tardes. Hola, Rodrigo. Hola, Edwin. Mira, tengo una pregunta. Me gustaría saber si tuvieras tenido la posibilidad de emigrar junto a tu familia a un país de habla hispana, ¿hubieras tú tenido la misma posibilidad de transformarte en la autora o escritora que eres hoy en día?
Okay, so we have just heard the question. The question was posed by Bruna Truffa, as I told you. She's a renowned visual artist from Chile, and she was wondering whether the fact that your family emigrated to New York and not to a Spanish-speaking country had any effect on the fact that you became a writer. Would you have become an author if your family had emigrated to Mexico or perhaps to Chile?
Ma salue moun ki moun aisyen kap gade sa kak pal presentasyon na Chile. I wanted to say hello to my brethren who might be watching this in Chile. You know, migration is such a big part of our experience, as you are seeing so many Haitians come to Chile. It was the same in the time that my parents moved to New York, and then I moved there when I was 12. I think I would have been a writer if I had moved anywhere, because it was such a strong passion for me. I probably would be something else in a writer, maybe a nurse writer, but I would have written maybe it's funny that this question came up because people always ask about the language question, right? And my answer is often, yes, if we had moved to Spain, I would be writing in Spanish. I think it's kind of also where at the time that where the language met my migration. And I feel like wherever that would have been, I would be writing in that language, yes.
And how would you have felt in French? What is your relation to the actual dominating language in Haiti, or the colonial language, I should say?
Yeah. Well, I think for me it felt, because we were, so in when I was in school in Haiti, if you spoke Creole to the teacher, you were like hit on you had to speak French. So there was a forced element to French, to the way it was in school. It was the way I had to write letters to my parents, you know, which were then rigorously corrected. There didn't feel too much pleasure in it for me. And then, but when you have also a language, like, of course, English is a dominating language in many places, but for me, it was a language where I could hide. So I, you know, my parents didn't always understand what I was writing, and there was a bit of a kind of mischievous freedom in that. So I think that was also part of the appeal of it. You know, it was just kind of a neutral language for me.
So in a sense, English was a third language.
Yes, it is a third
language. Even though English, it's also a colonial language, in your particular situation, it became a third language.
A third language. It wasn't my colony.
No, great. I can understand. It's neutral in your particular experience.
In that particular experience, yes.
Yes.
And then it was also a kind of a place where, like, I think sometimes when you don't know all the rules, it felt a little freer because I would read Toni Morrison and I felt, oh, that is very different than like the rappers I'm hearing, you know, and the Shakespeare I'm reading in school. There was all this, there was a kind of big range to it that I liked. I'm sure that exists in many, of course that exists in Spanish for sure. And I know it exists in French, but there it felt like, oh, this is a little bit, you know, this is where I was. You know?
Okay, let me translate that part. Mm-hmm. Bueno, entonces ella al escuchar la pregunta de Bruna Truffa se refiere a que la migración, la experiencia de la migración es parte de su formación también como artista. Una migración que sucedió a los 12, pero partió antes. Pero también la escritura proviene de una pasión tan grande que es muy probable que ella hubiese terminado como escritora sin importar el lugar a donde hubiese emigrado. Hace un pequeño chiste diciendo que podría haber sido una enfermera escritora en alusión a su biografía, porque una vez que termina su pregrado en la universidad, se preguntó a sí misma si seguía la carrera de enfermera y finalmente, afortunadamente diría yo, se decidió por la escritura. La migración se encuentra también con la reflexión sobre la lengua y la fascinación también con la lengua. Entonces, en ese minuto ella habla de la pregunta que a menudo le hacen de por qué ella decide escribir en inglés. Entonces ella habla de una comunidad más grande, de la cantidad de hablantes de inglés que existen, pero también porque el inglés en su situación particular vendría a ser una lengua más neutra, en el sentido que la lengua colonial de su niñez es el francés, y el inglés se inserta en su vida como una lengua tercera, que por cierto es colonial, pero no es colonial dentro de su propia biografía. Entonces ella es capaz de captar la amplitud que le ofrece, una amplitud que va desde los raperos, pasando por Toni Morrison y que se extiende hasta Shakespeare. Una amplitud que, por cierto, ella entiende que el español y otras lenguas también le pueden ofrecer, pero eso fue su experiencia biográfica. Ok, so I have some other questions from the audience. Someone is asking about the commitment that the migrant artist might have through writing. Is writing the best or the most efficient form of art for the migrant artist?
Well, I think, you know, often we don't choose the art, right? The art chooses us. I really feel that. Like, I couldn't decide tomorrow, because it's more efficient, that I'm going to paint. That wouldn't work. And I almost thought the question was going to be, is art the most efficient for the migrant, right? Mm-hmm. Our parents would say no. But I had this really, there's a writer from Colombia, American named Patricia Engel, who said this thing that I found mind-blowing. She said that all immigrants are artists because there's so many parallels between immigration and art, and you take risks, you're recreating yourself, you know, you're recreating a life when you move somewhere else. It's a form of art, you know, it's a form of art making in that sense. So I don't know that for me, writing is a powerful means of, and I think the person meant engagement, you know, like it's a really powerful means of engagement. For others, it's song. For others, it's visual art. But I think it has to be based on what is really moving the person's soul, you know, in terms of how best to engage, because ultimately people become artists because there's they have a really strong passion for art. And that's why people will sacrifice their lives for it, or they'll sacrifice their well-being, or they'll make all kinds of, sacrifices for their art because there's something very powerful about it that's driving them to it.
Muy bien. Ella, escuchando la pregunta, creyó que la pregunta iba a ser un poco más general y que iba a preguntar si es que el arte en general es lo más conveniente, lo más eficiente para cualquier migrante. Dice que sus padres habrían estado en desacuerdo con eso, absolutamente. Pero ella recuerda las palabras de una escritora colombiana que afincada en Estados Unidos, Patricia Engels, que dice que todo migrante está obligado a reinventarse a sí mismo, y por lo tanto es básicamente un artista, que todo migrante es un artista. Ella después señala que en su experiencia el arte, ella no se puede pronunciar sobre otros artes porque el suyo es la escritura, y es lo que para ella le vale la pena todos los sacrificios que hay que hacer, pero también es lo que le da un sentido, un propósito, incluso cierto grado de satisfacción espiritual. Okay, so there's a question by Juan Ursúa, and he's curious to know about your opinion on the relation between the population of migrants, especially people who come from African backgrounds or Afro-Caribbean backgrounds, and the people who are I shouldn't say the natives to those countries, but you know, to the local national population. He wants to know also if you're aware of certain tensions, not only in the States, but also in Latin American countries, even in Chile.
I'm very much aware of the tensions in Chile, because for us who are Haitian, Chile, migration to Chile is our most recent mass migration. And a lot of people we know have family members who've come to Chile, and we know that some of the difficulties they face there, and people often face difficulties, and you know, our people also, you know, in Brazil, which was previously the big migration, and elsewhere. I mean, I think there's in the United States too. It's especially the last 3 years. It's sometimes very clear that that people are resistant to migration, but are particularly resistant to migration of Black and Brown people. So those tensions are very, very deep. I know the experience of migration from the experience of being a Black and Brown person and having people I love, you know, deal with the difficulty of it. But I always, when you talk about the population where the people arrive, I mean, for me, and that's something I hope that my work also does, is to just remember, you know, remember that we have, people are, there's people just would not make these sacrifices if, you know, it's out of such urgency often that people make these sacrifices. You know, I think the best description of is a poet, Warson Shire, who said that no one leaves home unless home is the mouth of a shark, right? Especially in the conditions that many of our people have to leave home. And the reality is that there's going to be more and more migration as time goes by. But we have the climate issues. We have, and so our, you know, the hope is that there will be more opportunities for people to be able to stay home, but that there's also more humanity where people end up, because I am absolutely a result of migration, and the opportunities that I've had have been because my parents eventually were able to make a life here.
Mm-hmm. Bueno, ella dice que tiene muy claras las tensiones que se viven en Chile. Muchos tienen en Haití familiares con parientes aquí en este país, como también los tienen con personas que emigraron a Brasil, que era también el destino popular para los haitianos anterior al de Chile. Y sabe, bueno, que la gente se resiste a la migración, que eso es común, pero que esa resistencia es mayor cuando los migrantes son personas de color. Y eso produce por lo general una tensión muy, muy profunda, y es una tensión que ella vivió en carne propia en Estados Unidos. Recuerda las palabras del poeta Warston Shire, que dice que nadie dejaría su hogar, a lo menos que, o sea, si no fuera que ese hogar no se transforma, o sea, nadie deja su hogar si su hogar no se ha transformado en una boca de tiburón. Y bueno, también menciona una serie de problemas que se están agudizando ahora, entre ellos los problemas de cambio climático, que van a causar aún más migraciones, y ya tiene la esperanza de que surja un nuevo sentido de solidaridad en la humanidad para poder acoger a estos migrantes. Ella misma siente que su vida se la debe también al hecho que ella pudo forjarse un futuro como migrante. Okay, I'm going to choose a last question. There is one which is very interesting, is by Tomás Roque. He's the co-translator of your book.
Okay. He should have no questions.
Well, he does. The fact that he does, it means that your book is alive.
That's true. And then I should ask him a question.
Okay, so he wants to know whether there was a conscious decision to appropriate or to resignify the title of Camus' essay as a dominant French author.
Yes. Well, Camus is really one of the, when I remember reading when I was a young woman, L'Étranger, and then reading the essays and being really, you know, young women fall in love with that face, right? Mm. With the cool guy. And I just really, I love the work, but I love the essays. And this was, well, let me give the history of the whole book. So I was asked to give a lecture, which was named after Toni Morrison at Princeton University. And I was told a year ahead, and I struggled so much with what can I say in front of Toni Morrison. And then I was reading Camus at the same time on this idea of what it means to be an artist, and then remembering this history that I have. So I decided to use that lecture as a launching pad. And I recommend it to the audience. It's a wonderful and very powerful lecture. I think it's one of the last that he gave before he died. So it was a very inspirational, you know, I found it very inspirational. And Camus also had that difficult position. He was French, he was Algerian, and he was asked to take certain positions sometimes that he did not want to. And he wrote very clearly. So sometimes instead of, you know, saying what people would want him to say, he wrote very much, not just in this essay, but he wrote a lot around the issue of what it means to be an artist, what it means to be a committed, an engagé artist. So I felt I wanted to use that as a guide through this exploration of these committed artists in the book. And it was also a way to honor this essay by him that I really, really love. It's a very powerful, and he writes very lyrically in this way. I mean, all the essays are powerful, but this one is one of my favorites. So I wanted to use it as a launch pad to address these other artists.
Perfect.
So thank you for the question, and thank you for the translation.
Bueno, le hice una pregunta que publicó Tomás Rote en el chat, que es uno de los traductores del libro del cual ella acaba de leer. Y Tomás preguntaba sobre si es que había sido una opción consciente el robar o tomar prestado el título de un ensayo de Camus para su libro, considerando que Camus podría representar el idioma francés dominante. Y Edwidge, ella explica que ella amó esos ensayos desde muy joven. También confiesa que amó el perfil muy cool de Camus también cuando en su juventud. Pero esos ensayos fueron muy importantes por bastante tiempo. También coincidió que a ella le pidieron con un año de anticipación que hiciera una conferencia en torno a Toni Morrison. Y durante ese tiempo, ella, un poco obnubilada por la figura de Morrison y por la tarea, no sabía de dónde partir. Y ahí es donde ella regresa a Camus. Específicamente a la pregunta que él se hace, ¿qué es lo que significa ser un artista? Y ella tomó esos ensayos y esas palabras como punto de partida para elaborar su conferencia en esta convocatoria. Camus escribió mucho sobre el compromiso del artista, y a ella le sirvió esos escritos siempre como una guía vital. Y por lo demás también destaca el estilo de escritura de Camus, que a su juicio es bastante lírico, y eso la lleva, digamos, a una suerte de admiración por la escritura de Camus. Y por supuesto agradece la traducción de Tomás, así como también su pregunta.
Okay. I want to just add to that, yes. In Camus' diaries, he has some wonderful reflections about his time in Chile. That he quite enjoyed himself in Chile. A pleasure that I hope to also share one day.
Well, our doors are open, not just the screen. Dice que recuerda también la opinión que Camus tiene de Chile en sus diarios. Dice que lo pasó muy bien cuando estuvo acá y espera tener la misma posibilidad de poder viajar. Y por supuesto, nuestras puertas están abiertas para ella. Okay, Edwidge, I would like to thank you for your time. Thank you for sharing your your opinions, for sharing your work, part of your biography. I think you've been very generous. And I hope that people here have enjoyed it as well. I think that they've been very active in the chat with questions. So that must surely be a sign of profound enjoyment, because they've engaged with your work and with your ideas. So thank you very much. Y quisiera agradecerle a todos los agradecerle a todo el público, y quisiera invitarles a que permanezcan atentos a nuestro programa. Pronto traeremos a la escritora norteamericana Susan Howe. También vendrá pronto Selva Almada, también traeremos gente de Colombia. Esta pandemia nos tendrá en la casa, pero nosotros seguimos muy activos con nuestro programa, ofreciendo escritores de todas partes del mundo y enriqueciendo los diálogos y también nuestras lecturas. Muchas gracias. Hasta luego.
Gracias. Gracias, Rodrigo.
Goodbye.